Good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2024. There are no apologies this morning, and our first item of business is the consideration of a legislative consent memorandum and a supplementary memorandum for the UK Government's Criminal Justice Bill, and I refer members to Paper 1. In particular, members should look at Annexes A and B for details of the provisions in the Bill that impact on devolved competences. Members will wish to note that the Scottish Government is recommending consent as set out in the memorandums. So can I now invite views from members on whether you are in a position to consider a recommendation on consent at this point, or if you have questions that you would like answered first, thereafter we would return to the recommendation on a different day. So if I can maybe just open up to members to come in with any queries or questions that you may have. Any queries at all? Pauline McNeill.
It would be helpful to get some more information on some of the clauses and the implications of it. One of the questions I had was the various bodies that, in relation to clause 14, other clause about access to driver's licences. I mean, it would have been more helpful if they just set out what the various bodies were, for so we knew what that actually meant. And I would prefer to have seen the note from the Delegated Legislative Reform Committee before today. So I think the timing's a little bit tight. So I certainly think we need more information on this before I would be content to support the LCM. I've no objection, depending what other members think, to asking the Minister to come, but certainly would not be content to sign off without fully understanding the implications of both clauses, because on the face of it, it looks like the one in corporate liability in clause 14 would include senior managers, and that's quite a broad term. Who's regarded as a senior manager? I mean, I'm sure this has all been examined and worked out, but what we've been put in front of us is very light in terms of detail. And we've been asked to sign something off. I wouldn't be content without a full understanding of that.
OK, thank you. Anyone else? Russell Binley.
Thank you. I understand Pauline's concerns, but I have a few other points. I think, if I understand it correctly, the UK Criminal Justice Bill is substantial. There are 79 clauses, and the Scottish Government's asking us to adopt 6 of these today, numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 14 and 21, and they relate to a variety of subjects involving organised crime, child exploitation, printed guns, devices used in vehicle theft, and that kind of thing. I wholeheartedly agree with what these clauses do, and it's important to note that the papers cite the importance of UK-wide consistency in these matters and the risk to potential repercussions in terms of public safety if there was any divergence. So it's good to see the two governments working so effectively together. But what I think the outstanding questions are for me are, of the 79 clauses, of the outstanding 73, there's one or two that certainly jump out. I mean, politically, there will not be agreement between both governments in respect of all of it. But there's ones, for example, let me see, clause 23, which creates a new statutory aggravating factor in respect of child grooming. And on the face of it, I can't see any cause to disagree. It may be there's reasons why the Scottish Government haven't chosen to duplicate or replicate that or adopt it, whatever the phrase is. And the other thing is, I understand there's an amendment to the UK Government legislation relating to the prohibition of registered sex offenders changing their names, which is a bit of a hot issue, and it's something the Scottish Government have been asked about and have spoken about. So therefore, it might be for a later date, but I wonder whether the Scottish Government are in discussion with the UK Government about potentially adopting that at a later date as well.
Okay, so,
Thank you.
Put a lot in there, so yeah, that's helpful to have that set out. Anyone else want to come in? If not, I think, Stephen, I'll just bring you in just to pick up on a couple of those points.
So just to maybe give Deputy Convener a little bit more information there. So if it's a forthcoming amendment, I don't have information at the moment whether the Scottish Government is in discussion with the UK Government around that amendment. But if they are, and if there is a question about extending the impact of that amendment into Scotland, then that would very likelihood trigger another supplementary legislative memorandum that would need to be lodged in the Scottish Parliament, referred to this committee and looked at on a later date. So I'll try and keep the committee posted if any amendments such as that do impact on devolved issues, and therefore you're going to have to look at that separately.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Pauline McNeill.
Just one other question springs to mind when I was listening to Russell Findlay. I mean, some of it seems to be where we already have law on child grooming, so we've got specific legislation. I mean, I think it would be helpful to know from the Scottish Government's point of view, is there duplication here? I mean, I suppose my question is, criminal law is normally a matter for this Parliament, unless it's international, international organised crime. So I think we need to be clear as well why we would need offences that would be, say, an aggravation of an existing offence. And I think we need to know, well, does that then give the Crown the option of how it's charged? If you follow me, I mean, it may seem simple on the face of it, but normally devolved competence allows us, Scotland, to decide how it wishes to proceed, which I'm sure there are very good reasons for this content, but again, I think we need to ask the question because we certainly don't want any confusion around this.
Okay. Yep, Russell.
Just in respect of one of these clauses, the need for it to be UK-wide relates to the pill presses and prohibiting their purchase and trade or whatever. And that's something that the Scottish Government, as far back as, according to the Parliament website at least, we're talking to the Home Office about for at least 2 years. And obviously it would create a big problem if these were outlawed in the rest of the UK, but not here. So I think that one's pretty straightforward. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you. If there's no more questions, thank members for your feedback. That's very helpful. So I think just in view of the range of questions, the significance of the bill, it is indeed extensive in terms of its provisions that are being proposed. Obviously, we were quite late receiving the DPLR committee reports. I think in view of that, I'm happy for us to take away the questions and points that have been raised, and we'll seek appropriate views, and then we'll schedule another session further on in our work programme to come back on these LCMs with a minister in a few weeks' time, probably. So are members content with that proposal?
Yes.
Okay, thanks very much. Okay, thank you. So our second item is consideration of two negative SSIs, namely the Firefighters Pension Schemes Scotland Amendment Order of 2024, and that's SSI number 26 of 2024, and the Sexual Offences Act 2003 Prescribed Police Stations Scotland Amendment Regulations of 2024, and that's SSI number 30 of 2024. And I refer members to paper 2. So can I ask members if they have any questions on these instruments, or are we content with both? So Katie Clark.
Thank you. I have a question. I wouldn't in any way want to hold up the passage of this SSI 26, which removes historical discrimination. But there are some outstanding issues that aren't covered in the SSI, and I wondered perhaps if we could get further information from the Scottish Government on that. A significant part of the Fire Brigade Union UK-wide response to the consultation relates to the issue of aggregation, which is not covered in the regulations. this only applies to some members who joined the Fire and Rescue Service before April 2006, but it is an outstanding issue that I'm sure we would all want, or I would hope we would all want, addressed. So it would be useful to get an understanding of the Scottish Government's position on that. I appreciate there are UK-wide discussions ongoing, but it would be useful to know whether the Scottish Government considered going further itself or what representations it's making in relation to those issues.
Thanks for that, Katie, and we've noted that. Thank you. Russell Finlay.
Just in respect of both these SSIs, I'll start with the firefighter one that Katie's already mentioned. I see the Scottish Government have put the wrong date on this. It's a mistake. It doesn't look like it will have any impact whatsoever. However, the DLPR committee has said to us that this date should be corrected. It relates to death in service payments for firefighters. And they say that even though the wrong date's on the paperwork, they would honour any payments within what are considered to be the correct date. So their position appears to be, you know, trust us, it's not likely, and B, if it did happen, they would respect it. And I think that's in writing. But I just wonder, technically, whether we should consider ensuring, in line with what the DLPR committee has asked, that this is fixed before it proceeds, or whether we're happy as it is, whether it's just a technical matter. But we'll turn to the sex offender notification one now, quickly. So it essentially removes TAIN from the list of police stations in which registered sex offenders notification requirement takes place. Now, a Sunday Post investigation earlier this year found that there's been a significant rise in registered sex offenders in the Highlands, up 50% in 2 years, and this is attributed to sort of the people who are on the registered sex offender seeking to kind of find somewhere where they're perhaps not known. And I note on page 7, the Scottish Government say that the local councillor has been informed of what's going on. Local councillor singular. However, the ward of Tain and Wester Ross has got 3 councillors, and I'm curious as to know whether they've all been consulted. And I dare say they wouldn't be particularly objecting to registered sex offenders no longer attending at their local police station. Therefore, perhaps more importantly, have the councillors in the police station where they are now to be directed, have they been consulted on this? I don't want to slow it up, but just putting it out there.
Okay, thank you. I'm assuming that that's something we can take away and we can confirm. It's a fair point to raise, but I suppose coming back to the issue that we have in front of us today, can I just confirm that you're still content that we... that we're content with the SSIs as they are, and we can follow up the points that you've raised.
Is this a final position, or do we have time to...
Say again? Well, as it stands at the moment, what we're being asked today is to express that we're in agreement with the SSIs. So we've noted, obviously, the points that you've made.
Sure, we are.
Obviously, if you weren't, then that would hold things up. I would refer to Stephen in terms of the timescales that we have. But in any case, we're able to follow up the points that you've made and clarify them.
Therefore, in agreement, and glad that we can look at these points potentially.
Perfect. Yep. Is there anything you want to come in on, Stephen? Okay, so can I just confirm that... members are content with both the SSIs as they are, bearing in mind the comments that have been made. Okay, thanks very much. Okay, thank you for that. So that concludes our public agenda items for today. Our next meeting on the 13th of March, we will continue the consideration in private of our draft Stage 1 report on the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill. So we now move into private session.